Dear friends, in continuity of the lectures on cybercrime, I am Dr. Pratosh Bansal with you to give you all a detailed lecture on computer forensics investigations. Let's start our discussion while taking a look at what we are going to learn today. In today's lecture, we are going to learn about following modules as flash on your screen, and they are module 1, legal and privacy issues and introduction, legal and privacy issues in computer forensics, judicial systems for legal and privacy issues, module 4, examining forensically digitalized media, and then last we will have the conclusion of the chapter. So, computers are everywhere today, and a huge network of their networks exist as well. The internet makes it possible to exchange bulky amounts of data in various ways. The data packets may travel across the borders of various countries, getting stored and transmitted intermediately before they are delivered to the destination. So, this is the era in which our dependency on computer based facilities is increasing in leaps and bounds. This has given rise to cybercrime also. Cyber laws have been created and enforced by various countries to handle the same. Cyber forensics based activities help to gather evidence related with cybercrime. Let us go through some more aspects of cyber forensic investigations in this chapter to broaden our understanding. Earlier thinkers designated cyberspace as distinct from our real world. The criminal laws as such as connected with physical territories and cyber medium is not physical indeed. Does this mean that we let the cyber criminals enjoy? Will the cyber criminals keep on doing immoral activities and still not be sent behind the bars? Does this mean there is no safety and security in dealing online for business, banking, etc.? Why should we go for computerization if the cyber world is not safe? Let us understand the term jurisdiction first. The term jurisdiction basically encapsulates three concerns. First, does the misconduct of cyber criminals come under the purview of the court of the state concerned? Second, can the dispute related with the cyber crime be presented in the court for hearing? And third, does the state have the powers to enforce law with respect to the cyber crime in question? Let us consider an example. Misconduct that has taken place on a ship, in the sea, and on an airplane does come under the control and decision making of the country to which the ship or airplane belongs, and also the nations to which the victim and culprit belong. This may change from one country to another, but there are still ways for law and order to be enforced despite territorial boundaries that exist. The geographical location of conduct of crime is of prime importance in the physical world. The cyber world is in fact global, and the definitions that apply to law and order scenario in the physical world will need to be modified to accommodate the cyber world. We are free to distribute information across the internet. Certain types of information may be legal in one country, but may not be so in the other. In such a case, the other country may set its internet servers to block the display of such content which is not allowed by their laws. Some countries and their rulers are, as well as citizens, may find certain contents on the internet objectionable and may decide against displaying them. There must be same unison in the international laws to cover a broader spectrum of events and include the cyber crimes as well so that the world can become a better place to live. The geographical location from where the offense took place and the geographical location where the victim belongs, the nationality of the culprit and the victims, the extent of damage or harm caused, where is the evidence located, and what should be the level of punishment given to the culprit are our important concerns here. Unfortunately, the jurisdiction is not so clearly defined in the laws with respect to cybercrime, and hence we need stronger definitions that can extend across territories for the safety of the users of computer based facilities and also to ensure privacy and freedom for them at the same time. Extradition is yet another possibility when dealing with cybercrime. A country formally surrenders a person for prosecution in another country. This requires legislations to support this in both the countries involved and is more of a matter of bilateral relations and cooperative approach between the two countries. For extradition to take place, the crime under consideration must be defined as a crime formally in both the countries. For example, the love bug virus was originally created by some student of computer science in the Philippines. This virus destroyed lots of files and also stole passwords. It was first detected in Hong Kong in the year 2000 and later on it spread across the world. Siemens, NASA, Ford, etc. are among the organizations that were affected by it. Though the experts came to know who created it, but this virus had been used by many people to trouble others. Moreover, the Philippines had no definition of such a crime in their judicial literature and hence the creator of this virus could not be extradited to the USA. Several countries have modified their definition of extraditable crimes and this has extended to include cyber crimes as well. Computer forensics is tightly coupled with legal bindings as it is ultimately the court that will give the ruling in different cybercrime cases for which we have performed cyber forensics activities. Moreover, privacy issues also matter a lot because it may be possible that during cyber forensic analysis, the investigators may seize private data of the suspect which may have nothing to do with the crime under consideration. Let us go through the legal and privacy issues related with computer forensics one by one. First, there must be a know-how of the jurisdictional concerns. The state government and central government may have variations in their legal approaches. International judiciaries may have their own unique ways to deal with the similar concerns. Second, presenting computer-based evidence poses a problem in the court. There may be mechanisms to thwart the claims from the defense. The admissibility of digital evidence is indeed difficult to deal with. However, the cyber crime is also computer based. The courts may have their own constraints as to how such evidence should be presented presented authenticated and used for proceedings. If evidence is to be presented across jurisdictional boundaries, the cyber lawyers presenting these evidences must be well informed about the cyber laws of the land where they are being used for legal reasons. Next, we need a worldwide standard regarding the acquisition, preservation, analysis, and presentation of digital evidence with respect to cyber crime. At present, there is no consensus with respect to this aspect of cyber laws in cyber forensics. Fourth, the lawyers dealing with cybercrime and all the people involved in the judiciary that are dealing with this must have adequate computer literacy to understand the cybercrime and give proper ruling. Fifth, the data collected from seized computers both at the victim's end and the culprit's end may be extremely confidential with reference to their business and its security may be a prime concern. Many a times, the seized media and data may have nothing to do with the cybercrime concern. If the entire hard disk is replicated, there is a chance that even a lot of intellectual property of the person concerned may be left open for viewing by investigators, though they have no rights whatsoever to touch such data that has no concern with the cybercrime. Next, there may be acts related with interception of telecommunication in various countries that may be utilized for helping us in presenting cyber evidence during court cases dealing with cybercrime. Seventh, computer-based surveillance to ward off cybercrime is also in practice these days, but the prime concern is whether the employees under such surveillance is getting proper privacy or not. The companies must set surveillance mechanisms as per legal norms and must respect the boundaries of their employees as well. 8. There must be laws, norms, and standards regarding the preservation of privacy of business clients, even though information concerning them may be obtained and utilized for cyber forensics investigations. Many private organizations do not report about cybercrime as they fear negative publicity that may lead to losing business and clientele. Ninth, there must be cooperation on international level among the nations and their judiciaries to facilitate cyber forensics investigations for the highest level of law and order to be imposed all over the globe and to put a check on cybercrime. Tenth, laws related with exchange of information among countries should be revised and enforced to facilitate cyber forensics activities for the greater benefit of human civilization on the whole. 11th, there must be clear definition of cybercrime and its types, and there must be laws for dealing with the same. 12th, anonymity over internet is a ban indeed, and there must be some method to catch hold of culprits that commit cybercrime staying anonymous. There must be a legal method to launch actions against such unknown people. Next, the tools and techniques used in cyber forensics activities must be validated by some competent third party to ensure that legal boundaries and privacy of individual concerned remain intact. 14th, there must be some standards so that the expertise level of cyber forensics investigators can be assured before the court when producing computer based evidences of cyber crimes. In essence, we can cover all of the above concerns under three heads as such. First, flexibility of the judicial system. Second, privacy concerns. And third, multi-jurisdiction based approach. Flexibility of the judicial system. The judicial system must be able to adjust as per technological progress. This is improving the coordination between the judiciary and technology. The incompatibility between the law and technology gives rise to the legal issues related with cyber forensics. The lawyers need to be computer literate, and cyber forensic experts need to know the law for ensuring compatibility between these two streams of expertise also, so that they can work synergistically. This will help create clear guidelines for cyber forensic investigations in coherence with the law. This kind of activity for bridging the gap between these two fields will make our cyber laws better, and cyber forensics will be better able to assist in the process of penalizing cyber criminals. Privacy concerns. We need to have protocols for cyber forensics investigations so that the privacy of people and their data can be taken care of without hindering the investigation process. Moreover, even the users of computer-based services need to be well informed about the way in which they can work safely. This also includes intellectual property rights. As many a times, IPR, the intellectual property, may be left open before the investigators when they seize suspicious media. Multi-jurisdiction based approach. Since the internet is spread all over the globe, and so is the expansion of the universe of cybercrime and cybercriminals, we need a standardized approach that should be accepted worldwide in order to grapple with cybercrime. We need some standard setting body that would have experts from all over the world with their fair knowledge of computers and law for this to happen. We are now going to reiterate some salient details regarding forensically sterile media, and that we have discussed in the previous lectures also. The investigators are supposed to work on forensically sterile media so that the original storage units remain intact. The data on the hard disk are copied to another media so as to ensure the safety of the original data and hard disk. Once the copies of the hard disk data are created for forensic examination, the original disk is kept safely untouched to preserve its sanity. Even the ambient data are retrieved at the same time. There are various hardware and software mechanisms to retrieve deleted files as well. The investigators do their best to capture as much of relevant data as possible to facilitate smooth work that will be based on reliable information and will give satisfactory results. There are no strict standards regarding the admissibility of digital evidence, and this may even create problems for the parties involved in the court case related with cybercrime. It is indeed an order to search for relevant evidence in the ocean of data available on the hard disk today. We know that even opening a file will change its attributes related with last access, last modification, etc. Some people hence say that digital evidences are not trustworthy by default. Hence, there should be properly defined cyber forensics investigators and accredited organizations approved by government that can be given the responsibility of keeping and retrieving digital evidences related with the cyber crimes. Though issues exist, there is no evidence progress on this front to find a plausible legal mechanism for the same. In our country, CDEC Trivandrum is providing government the certified software for dealing with the forensic cases. In 1999, the following guidelines adopted by the International High Tech Crime Conference for preserving admissibility of digital evidence. First, upon seizing digital evidence, action should be not change that evidence. When it is necessary for a person to access original digital evidence, that person must be forensically competent. All activity relating to the seizure, access, storage or transfer of digital evidence must be fully documented, preserved and available for review. An individual is responsible for all actions taken with respect to digital evidence while the digital evidence is in their possession. Any agency that is responsible for seizing, accessing, storing or transferring digital evidence is responsible for compliance with these principles. In 1996, the Computer Crime Group was established by the Association of Chief Police Officers of United Kingdom that has published a good practice guide to collect the computer evidence, which provides the four important principles to the seizure of the computer system and handling of computer evidences. Disk imaging is in itself a boon so that the copies of the original disk may undergo physical and logical analysis, while the original version remains safe and can be produced in the court as evidence if required. It is a trend to create image of the entire disk. Sector-wise analysis is carried out specifically to gather ambient data that may contain helpful clues and evidences for our analysis. There are various methods of imaging. In fact, it is generally not possible to create an exact duplicate, but investigators have endeavored to create copies that are as close to the original disk as possible. Sometimes the entire data on the hard disk may not be needed. We go for selective copying in such cases. There are as follows: sector by sector, as it is imaging of the original disk to create a duplicate disk for forensic analysis. Disk mirroring, in which we try to map the track, sectors and cylinders of the original hard disk to the duplicate one. A bit by bit image can also be created. Sector by sector imaging of a specific partition of the original disk in which we suspect the presence of valuable information. Bit stream duplication is also carried out. By ambient data, we mean those portions of the disk that are not accessible logically or by applications. Though we delete files, they are not actually deleted, but they are simply marked for deletion in the file map and they get eventually replaced by the data of new files. Not all data get overwritten. The select portion of the old files can still be retrieved using hardware and software mechanisms. The resident data may remain in clusters, and we do have methods to reconstruct the files that were deleted earlier. There is always a probability of getting the lost data backup to some degree and utilize it for forensic analysis. The duplicate copies may be mounted on Unix or Linux based systems or systems using other operating system for further analysis. The investigators can work comfortably with the copies of the seized hard disk without any concerns of tampering of evidence. In fact, even the laboratory where these investigations are carried out should be a safe zone for these activities, where intruders cannot get in physically or electronically. In this lecture, we tried to learn various legal and privacy related concerns that are connected with cyber forensics. Our investigation procedures should be carried out in such a way that the organizations and people involved can continue working smoothly as per their routine work without getting disturbed, and the privacy of their individuals also remains unhindered even though surveillance mechanisms may be put in place. We have also seen what does jurisdiction mean and how this should be made flexible enough to encompass cybercrime and the cyber medium to make the cyber space a better place for its users and to set adequate controls on cyber crimes and endeavor to eradicate them. We need more literary people and experts in the fields of law and justice, social behavior and information technology to put their heads together to create mechanisms for expanding the jurisdiction of nations with reference to cybercrime, give more accurate definitions for the legal parameters involved, define extraditable offenses as clearly as possible, and let international and global laws be enforced to ensure the safety of users of computer-based facilities. We have also gone through the importance of using forensically styled media in our investigations so that the original media is kept safe and can be used during the quest for proper justice in court cases that involve cybercrime. With all this information, here we come to the end of today's lecture on this important unit of BA Criminology. Do keep in mind what we discussed today. I will be back with one more lecture in this series. If you want to learn more and enhance your knowledge, you may log on to our website www.cc.nic.in for MCQ, quizzes, LORs, etc. Thank you for your time today. I will see you in the next lecture. Have a great day. Thank you.